Hey, good evening, so good day, students. Welcome to another lesson. We've completed our first set on team performance, the previous set, and today we're going to continue with the next part on team performance, and that is all about conflict. So I want you to first grasp the big picture, and when you understand that, then you can zoom in and study the detail. Now, you don't need to know every single bit, but I would suggest that when you study at least 4 to 6 bullet points. Okay, except when you get to the conflict handling, that's quite something that's unique, and that you can grasp the whole cycle of, because it's quite logical and it follows each other quite nicely. So the outcomes for this lesson, we're going to focus on two topics. The first one is conflict. You need to be able to understand what causes the conflict. You have to name, explain, describe, discuss. Now, firstly, when they give you the question, this is an example question. You need to be able to understand what they ask. So first one is mention. You just name, outline, you name, explain, describe, discuss. This is not just a sentence. You have to now say this conflict, and then you have to explain it by elaborating on what it means. Okay. Second one is identify causes from the given scenario. So they'll give you a scenario and you have to say which is which causes. Okay. Explain to businesses or advise them on how they should handle conflict. This you can make, you can try and apply that in your daily lives as well. And the next topic is, dealing with grievances and difficult people or personalities. You need to differentiate between a grievance and a conflict. This is quite a popular question. Number two, you have to explain or discuss the correct procedures to deal with grievances. You have to name the following difficult people or personalities from specific scenarios. Which is your complainer, indecisive person, the over-eager beaver, the negative person, expert, and a quiet person. And then lastly, you should be able to recommend ways in which business can deal with the difficult people or personalities in the workplace. Okay, so there's 7 outcomes, and trust in this video you'll be able to answer all of that. Alright, the 8th one suggests ways in which a business can deal with difficult. Okay, so it's exactly the same one. Alright, so vocab, what you need to understand. So this is the same as if you've looked at your notes. Mutual, it means two people sharing the same feeling. Commitment, that means there's you keep to a promise, arrangement, or a cause. That means you're committed to it, you're not intending to change a lot. Accountable means you are held responsible for your actions. Interpersonal attitudes means personality that the person continuously develops. Interpersonal behavior is how 2 or more people will interact with one another. Shared values is a group of people with the same set of standards. And assess is you check how well something has been done. So let's delve into conflict resolution. So firstly, you have to understand where does conflict originate from? Where does it come from? And why do we need to resolve it? Now, it might sound stupid, it might sound, why are we doing this, why do we need to understand how conflict work? When you look at the team, we looked in a previous session, we looked at the team and the team performance, and we understand that teams are built up out of many different diverse individuals, and when you put diverse in the same sentence, with people that do not like to change or has their mindset on their own view, you are bound to find a collision, explosion, conflict. A good example, one of the earliest examples of of our teamwork started out excellently was the Tower of Babel. They were working and building, and it got so high, and then the people got proud. And then a miracle happened. The Lord gave them all different languages. And suddenly, because of the lack of communication, their teamwork was disrupted. Now, I don't think there was a nice feeling there. I don't think people left on a good foot. Suddenly, you're in a different place. Suddenly, the whole atmosphere changed. Suddenly, you can't understand someone. It's frustrating. And now there's conflict. So instead of resolving it, each and everyone found someone with a similar language, and they went and settled in different parts of that land. Okay, so conflict resolution is very important. Now, that was an important part in history, in Bible, but that just shows you an example of good communication and what happens when you take that away. All right, so first thing, when you look at what causes conflict in the workplace, difference in backgrounds or cultures, values, beliefs, language. The moment you put that into a workplace, everyone's got their own view, own opinion, and you view that more highly than the person next to you, and you think your way is right. There's no respect, and it's not until the point that you respect others that you can solve conflict. Otherwise, you'll always go in with that superiority complex. Next one, different opinions. Everyone's entitled to their opinion, but your opinion doesn't make it fact. Okay, so that causes a lot of conflict, stress. Unfair workload, when you feel you're burdened, you've got too much, and others are just playing around, they're sitting playing solitaire, and you're working till 3 o'clock in the morning. That's not right. Unrealistic expectations, as you can see in this cartoon. It says, this is the real me, me as I really am, reality. And then the other guy freaks out and says, how dare you not live up to my expectations. So we sometimes see unrealistic expectations, or we build that which does not really exist. It's a figment of our imagination, and we think that's what people expect from us. If it's not clear communication, then that's normally one of the first things that will come. People will start seeing that there's such a high expectation of them, and which is unrealistic, it's not attainable, and that causes conflict. So just clear communication can solve that quickly. But you can also set that for yourself. If you aim and you just want to achieve, which is not really possible in a short time frame, it will cause a lot of conflict in yourself, inner conflict, and that would lead to a lot of outer conflict as well. Poor communication, I believe, is the heart of most of the conflict situations. As you can see here, it's two tens. People are trying to convey a message the old way, and it's not really effective. Unclear responsibilities, which means if you're not certain whose job is whose, then it's one of those balls that's in the air and it will fall. Okay, so no one knows whose responsibility is, and everyone gets mad at everyone for someone not doing their work. So you have to be able to identify these causes from specific scenarios. So that should not be a difficult hurdle to cross. So let's explain the causes in the workplace. Lack of communication. Okay, so firstly, when there's a lack of communication, that means people are not talking. To put that simply, when people are not talking, no one knows on what the progress is, no one knows where each other is standing, what they're working on, what's the goals, if there's a common goal, if they can help. So that means someone with a high workload will continue to work hard, while someone with less work, who might be able to help him, sits and do nothing. Or someone with expertise in a group can share it, but because there's no communication, that expertise does not get then unlocked. So communication is quite crucial. When you ignore rules for a second one, you break a specific set of boundaries which keeps everyone safe. Now everyone is bound by the same rules, and that gives it a safe framework. It's when we give you rules for a school, you have to dress in the same attire, you have to be at the school at the same time, you go to the same class, you sit on the same chairs. Everyone's treated same or the same, it's an equal, everyone is treated fairly. So everyone is put in the same opportunity, and if you ignore rules, then there's this part that gets broken. So that safety, that trust is gone. And now you get favoritism, now you get things of I am better, I can break the rules, the rules don't apply to me, and that will cause conflict. Not only that, if you break rules, it will cause conflict in a literally sense. If you steal, if you break the rule, you will have to face conflict, face the music, and be accountable for your actions. Different personalities, backgrounds, I need to say too much about that. Everyone's got their own background, own story, own viewpoint, and that in itself is enough reason for conflict. Different values, levels, knowledge, skills, all come together. There's little or no cooperation between stakeholders, as I said earlier. If you do not work together, if there's no communication, that will be a massive source of conflict. Lack of recognition for good work. This is very important. Now, this is more, this can be between team members, but if there's no recognition from the top, from management level, even if it's just supervisor or team level, then you would feel your work goes unnoticed. And although recognition from peers is good, if it doesn't come from management level, then sometimes people feel that that management doesn't, they just expect, but they don't reward. And that would lead to you not performing constantly, or the person performing constantly. Because they would feel, why should I do this? I performed and nothing happened, so why should I continue? So recognition is always good. Lack of employee development, that means quite simply, I need to develop as an employee. I need to develop physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually. I need to study or want to grow in my knowledge. So there's a lot of programs that companies offer you to join and to enrich yourself. Because they know if you enrich yourself, you enrich the company. And if there's a great morale, you're unlikely to go. Okay, so if there's no development, you might feel stuck. You might want to consider moving to another company that will offer you these benefits. And that will lead to conflict. It starts at a small seed and then it grows. Unfair disciplinary procedures, that's quite the important one. If you are late for a meeting and now suddenly you are fired without getting a letter or a warning, formal warning, that is not fair, and you will have grounds actually to combat that. But in the meantime, that means there is unresolved conflict. That actually shows that there is some other conflict that needs to be solved. Because that to me is an unsolved issue that pops up in this topic. Okay, so how do we handle? The first things first, you need to acknowledge the elephant in the room. What is the problem? You need to know there is a problem, acknowledge it, see there's a conflict. Now you have to identify where does this conflict come from? What's the source? Is it... remember now, the conflict, you've identified the conflict. Okay, the conflict is your workload. Okay, what's the cause? Okay, is it the workload? Is the workload the cause? No. The conflict starts actually with the manager giving the work to you and not to your co-workers. Okay, the workload is just an outflow of this. It's almost like a vessel, if I can say it. It's what you put on your face. You know, you're mad. We tell our 2 and 3 year old kids when they are unhappy and they're mad and they're about to throw a tantrum and they've got this face, this lip that's hanging there. They're a tractor gathering mud or ground in their mouths, because they can't close their mouths, and this bottom lip is just dragging along and filling up. That's the outcome. That's the result of that. But the cause is, who caused it? What was the cause? So that would be the manager that would allocate more work to you and not fairly distribute it, because you have to identify the cause. So now you've got the cause. Now you have to arrange pre-negotiations. Okay, so now you can say what's your complaints. Okay, and you state that separately. So you would probably say to your team leader, listen, I feel it's unfair. I mean, there's too much work and the other team members are not getting any work. So you can state your case plainly, and you don't have to go to the manager who is in who gave you the workload, and he can state his case to someone else, and it's a pre-negotiation. That means there's no interaction yet. It's just that everyone gets to state their case, almost like you're giving your statement at the police office. Then you have to arrange a time and place for negotiations where this meeting will take place. Okay, so you have to say, let's meet at this time at such a place and to negotiate, and the manager should be present, and you with the conflict or the problem or the grievance, well, not grievance yet, but the problem, we will have to meet. Then you arrange a meeting. And then in that meeting, once that meeting takes place, we have to set the goals. What is the intentions? Okay. So what will happen if we have an intervention? So that would be stated so that everyone knows, okay, the outcomes will be for the better of everyone. We're not going to fire anyone now. So everyone's put at ease. And the main aim here is to take out the sting. Okay. We need to take out the part that hurts, and to take out that cause, to fight the root of the conflict. So what's the intervention? How are we going to act about it? Okay, then each party can express their own opinions or feelings, right? This doesn't necessarily have to be the facts, but this is what they feel. This is what's true to them, so they have to express their own feelings. But if it's based on facts, that's obviously the best. If you just make them give fictitious reasons, if it's not based on anything true, then I doubt that it will go any further. Okay, conflicting parties may then recognize that their views are different. Okay, so now the manager and the team member, they voice their opinions, their viewpoint, and then I realize, you know, from a manager's point of view, I understand why I did that. And it's different, or I really don't see his point. It's so different that I cannot comprehend it. And same from the manager. They just realize that their views are too different. So then you have to evaluate the causes. If there's no solution, if at that point that they cannot solve it, you have to analyze or evaluate the causes, and you have to break it down into different parts. So why did the manager give that workload? And then the explanation can come, and then the manager can say, but he's the only one with the expertise. He's the only one that's really energetic, and I see him working the hardest, and I feel that I can trust him the most. And suddenly, with this perspective, things might change. Okay, and you also then have to say, but I feel that this person doesn't do their job well, and then that can be addressed. Okay, so now the next thing is, you should not start blame shifting. Okay, it's all about you stating your case, but not to put the blame on someone else. Remember, you want to solve conflict, not shift the blame. Blame shifting is not problem solving, it's not conflict resolution, it's just putting it out there and not handling it efficiently. So both parties should make sure that they're focused on finding a solution. It doesn't help if you're in it just to make a point. That's just a time waste. If everyone just wants to make their point without finding a solution or in it to find a solution, then it will be fruitless, time wasting exercise. So that must be their goal. So next step is to devise possible ways or brainstorm ways to resolve this conflict. So In this case, the manager can say, okay, I hear you, I see that you're busy, I really am sorry. If I lighten your burden, what would that look like? What, how can I do to help you lessen your load? How about if I make you team leader and you delegate the work, but you're still responsible for the end product? That might be an option. So there's different ways to do that. Okay, so then both parties can agree on the criteria to evaluate the alternative to see if it will work. And then they can select and implement the best solution. Now, it might not be the right one the first time. They can go and test it. If it works, it's fine. If it doesn't work, they can come back and discuss it again. And then there's opportunities for the parties to agree on the best solution. And then you can evaluate or follow up on implementation. How did it go? Did it work? And then progress should be monitored. So how does it work? Did it work well? Can you make adjustments? How about doing this in such a manner? How about doing things so? How about involving more people? Etc. etc. Right. And then if you can also source experts on handling it from outside. So this comes in when there's a third party, totally anonymous, totally unbiased. And then normally what would happen is they would listen and then they would give us type of a judgment where that would either solve it or this can then escalate. So let's look at the difference. What's the difference between a grievance and a conflict? Grievance means there's an unhappy employee, it's because of work, and it's the cause is discrimination, or the issue at hand is discrimination. Okay, they feel that they're being discriminated against, they can't apply for a position because of their race or culture, and that makes them unhappy. Conflict is just a clash of ideas. Okay, so that means I like blue, you like red. We need to build a presentation and I want it blue, you want it red. We can't agree on an idea and there's a disagreement and we can't settle it. That is conflict. You see the difference. Okay. Grievance, with what law is that related to? That was also a question I think I asked in a previous class. Now I only think Simon answered it. Thank you, Simon. All right. Now, the correct procedure to deal with grievance. Remember, we agreed this process, we dealt with conflict, how to solve conflict. Now, we're doing grievance. Okay, so what's the procedure to deal with grievance? The aggrieved employee must then report the incidents to his or her supervisor. So, you need to take it to the next level of management. And you've got a time frame, 3 to 5 days. Remember, this is a work-related issue. You feel discriminated against, so you need to go to your supervisor, your team leader, or your manager within 3 to 5 days and give a verbal report. Okay. Then, if you cannot resolve this grievance in that time period, okay, why 3 to 5 days? Because then it's still fresh, it's still raw, and it's the best time to try and solve it while it's everyone's still involved. Okay, so it's easy for a manager to step in at that time. But should it not be resolved, there's a next level of escalation. They can take you to the next level of management. That means you move to a more formal process, you lodge a complaint in writing, okay, and then you fill in a grievance form, and that means it's escalated. So the employee must receive a written reply and response to his written grievance. So I submitted my grievance verbally. We've had our meeting, didn't work, or not meeting, but now I'm escalating it. So after a week, I submit my written grievance and then I have to receive a written reply. What was the management's response? And then a grievance hearing or meeting must then be held with all the relevant parties that's present. So the minutes of the meeting should be recorded and any resolution that's passed must be recorded on a formal grievance form. Okay, this is important. Why do you need to keep minutes of the meeting? That means everything that was said or noted or discussed is written down. Okay, so if you agreed, on something in a meeting, and you back down on your agreement, that is a fault on your side. So it's mandated for everyone's protection to say what was said, what was agreed upon, so that everyone can refer back to it. Okay, and any resolution passed must be recorded in a formal grievance form. So now the resolution passed, okay, that means someone gave a solution or a possible option to resolve this grievance. That has to be recorded formally. Okay, now it's in writing, it must be on file, so that if something is escalated, we've got files to prove it was handled in the correct form. Why? If you go to Labour Court or CCMA and they'll ask you how was this procedure handled, it's easy to say we talked about it, but there's no proof of you talking about it. But if you have minutes, if you've got a meeting, if you have proof of the meeting, and if you've got formal documents to prove your case, then you are covered. Okay. Now, should the employee still not be satisfied, he can refer the matter to the highest level of management. Okay. The top management should arrange a meeting with the relevant parties. Again, minutes should be kept, filled in, and the outcomes must be recorded. If he's not still satisfied, he can refer then to the CCMA. This is the Commission, the Council for Conciliation, Mediation, Arbitration, and they will make a final decision. If they're still not satisfied, they can appeal to the Labour Court to see if there's an alternative, and that normally settles it. Okay, so now we're looking at the I hope in this after this you should understand the difference and see the different steps, and it's logical, it makes sense. So I would take keywords from this. Okay. And for example, I would say the first one is verbal report. I would understand the first step is verbal report. Okay, I have to report this verbally, 3 to 5 working days, and then I'll build my sentence around that. I would say if there's no resolution to the grievance, I escalate to the next level of management. Then formal process, which is lodged in writing, a grievance form. Okay, so I'll just, to study it, I'll just shorten it a lot, but make sure that I understand the detail of it. Okay, that shouldn't take too long. Okay. So, let's look at the different personalities. The complainer, whiner, indecisive is a person that's yes, no, maybe, don't know. Overeager beaver. You know all of them, they just can't wait for any opportunities. Negativity, those people that you want to avoid, like a stop sign. An expert that knows everything, and a quiet person that never says a word. So you've got these 6 personalities in the workplace. More, but these are the difficult type of personalities. Now, you can identify yourself in them. If I give you the option of thinking, if you were to do the trolley race, right, would you be fitting, would you see yourself in one of these categories? Maybe you're overeager, you can't wait to get it started. Maybe you're complaining and thinking, this is a time waste, I don't want to build a trolley, this is stupid. Maybe you're indecisive, like, I don't know, maybe you should do it, maybe you should not. Maybe the trolley should be red, now it should be blue. Or you're the expert and knows everything and everyone should listen to you and only you. Or you're the quiet one, you just sit there and watch the party. Or you're the negative one and you're not interested at all. Okay, so there's a few different personalities, not everything is discussed, but these are the 6 main difficult personalities. So how can businesses deal with difficult personalities? So first we list the type and then the strategy. So the complainer, how do you deal with them? You have to listen to their complaints, but not necessarily acknowledge them. Why? Okay, if I acknowledge every complaint that the complainer gives, that gives them a foothold. Okay, not a foothold, but they've got a platform suddenly to voice, and then it will not stop. Okay, so I'll listen, but I will not acknowledge it. Why? If I acknowledge it, then you will agree to every complaint that is truth, and mostly complaints If the person is a complainer, it will mostly just be because of his attitude and not something that's concrete. If there's something concrete, by all means, agree, give them the acknowledgement, solve it. But listen to the complaints, but do not acknowledge them, okay? And then interrupt the situation and move to the problem-solving process. So take them out of this more situation and then get to solving the problem. Say, stop moaning. Let's solve this thing. How can we solve it, okay? That's a good way to solve the issue of complaining people. Indecisiveness, that means this person cannot decide. Yes, right, no, yes, maybe. Let's stop. So guide them. You have to guide them. You have to stay in control. Remember, they can't make a decision. So you have to make the decision. That means you have to have the control. Emphasize the role or importance of making decision. And then help them. Show them the route. Why is this important to make this decision? How do you make this decision? Guide them step by step. Let them experience it and empower them. I would say also another thing is you should empower them to make the decision. Sometimes they might feel that they can't make the decision, and then you've got the ability or the influence to help them to make the decision, to step up and make the decision. The over-eager, this is the beaver. Now you have to be firm there and do not let them make promises they cannot keep. Okay, if they said it, hold them accountable and let them make that promises, but make them keep them. Okay, and follow up. Don't micromanage here, but follow up. If they said it, follow up. In time, they'll see that their over-optimism and over-eagerness, that's not over-agree. It's over-eager. Somehow that missed came in. So they have to understand that they have to be accountable, and that will quiet down their over-eagerness a bit. Their negativity. Okay, be firm with them. Don't let them draw the supervisor into their negativity. That's the first thing that spreads the quickest, and it's like fire. Negativity. If you're negative, you'll influence so many more people, and it's quicker to influence people in a negative way than in a positive way. Why? People like to complain. They like to see the negative side. And so drawing them in is quite easy. So be firm, don't let them draw them into their negativity. That can be supervisor or any person. Listen, but do not agree. As we said with the previous slide, listen to the complaints, but don't acknowledge. Listen to the negativity, but don't agree. Why? You will be influenced, and it will empower them to continue being negative. Expert. Again, be firm and assertive. Okay? Why? You also have an opinion. You also know how it works. He or she's not the only expert. Again, listen, but know your facts. Okay, when they've got something that is credible, give them acknowledgement. If it's just something they think they know, okay, but show them right on your facts. Educate them. But do not accuse them of being incorrect, and do not get caught in their game. Okay, do not start playing the expert game as well. Because that will just empower them to continue doing that. And now the last one is the quiet person. So do not fill their silence with words. Sometimes it might feel, you know, it's awkward. We're just looking at each other, and the person is quite content, and you're feeling awkward, and you're feeling the pressure. Don't fall in. Wait for response. Ask them. Put them on the spot. Give them a response, or wait for the response. And prompt them through the process so they can give input. Okay, guide them again. This is all about education. Guide them. Ask their input. Tell them how valuable they are and that they can make a contribution. And then restrict the time of the discussion. When they see that it's not going to continue forever. Sometimes people are just quiet because they want to get this meeting over and done with. Okay, so restrict the meeting. Make sure it's short, sweet. And make sure that everyone knows that their input will be valued. And then give them time. Okay, and sometimes you have to stop someone else and ask for their opinion. Okay, and even though it's awkward, you have to stick it out. Sometimes they will start answering, and then you get in or so much value from that one answer that was more than the whole meeting or worth every every minute that you waited for it. Okay, so these are six strategies that you can deal with different personalities. Then it's another one that was not listed, the aggressive personality. Okay, now this person, we see a lot of them on Facebook. They attack anyone that's against them. So allow them time to speak, blow off, get the steam out, but be firm and do not attack. Okay, when you attack, it's just a fuel again to fire their fuel, and then you'll be in a fight. So don't attack, be firm, tell them this is not on. We don't do things like that, and do not allow them to be hostile. Okay, take away the whole aggression, take away the sting, put them in a neutral setting, take away anything that can build up their aggression and ensure that they're not in another place. So you should be able to identify it from scenarios and suggest strategies to deal with it. Okay, so how can we also deal with difficult personalities? How can businesses deal with difficult personalities? They should get perspective from others who have experienced the same kind of situation. Okay, so firstly, you draw from experts that was in the same boat. You will ask them, listen, how did you do it? But other business owners, friends, family, you will draw from their experience. And then they can give you perspective. You know what, for the quiet person, this didn't work, but we finally managed to get them to answer, and their input was incredible. Act proactively. Okay, a staff personal problem is part of a manager's responsibilities. So proactively is not reactively. It's not, you should be able to start not looking into the future, but seeing what possibilities might occur. What's the probability that something might occur? Okay, so proactive means you've got a contingency plan. So you can see something can go down south very quickly, and you can either let it go and let it pan out, or you can step in and stop it immediately. If you don't step in, you'll have to act on a reactive basis, try and fight the flames after the fire was started. But proactive means you kill it while it was a spark. Okay, so you have to protect your staff, and that is, you have to protect them from the difficult personalities. Regular meetings with supervisors or department heads should help to identify the problem behavior. When you have different meetings, you can share information. Everyone knows who's the troublemakers. But now it's important. When you have these meetings, it's as easy to label someone, and then that person is labeled. Okay, everyone will have that glass, that lens on. Every time they see that person, he's the negative guy, and everything he says will be negative because he's labeled negative. So ensure that you address the problem and not the person. Okay, so these meetings should address the problem. Say this, and this was again discussed. This was a negative topic, but make sure that when there's a positive thing, that's also highlighted. Okay, ask someone in authority for their input. Okay, refer, get more input, and identify the personality which is creating the problem. That is very important. You can't address quiet if it's aggressive. That personality, that's a problem. Meeting privately with difficult employees, that is sometimes the best, because sometimes they feel, you know, they're not, their voice is not heard, and they just want to have a one-on-one. That's all they want. They just want to be heard. Okay, so set a private meeting. Don't involve, don't shout it out over the mountaintops, don't tell everyone about it. Just draw them in, quiet, quick conversation, have a cup of coffee, discuss it, and sort it out. But it's not a friend here, it's just keep it formal, but you can break the ice. Okay, it's not a suit and tie formal, but keep the setting formal, keep the meeting formal, but make sure that it's based on a relationship that they're free to talk. Okay. Last page. If the deadline date has passed, this should be discussed with a difficult employee, and the progress that was monitored or assessed, they should have a progress report on why they didn't meet the deadline. Okay, guidelines. You can give them guidelines on how to improve. You should not judge a person, like I said, don't label them, but understand them, understand their intention, understand why they react, and fight the cause of that. Okay, keep the communication channels open, encourage them to communicate the grievances, and then build rapport, that's relationship, and re-establish that personal connection with colleagues. Okay, don't just send emails, take them in, have a cup of coffee. Remain calm and in control of situation to get the persons to collaborate. Now, all of this is very, it's nice ideas. Okay, the application, however, it requires a very firm person. It requires that the person is not only smart with regards to your IQ, but it's also got emotional intelligence, your EQ. Okay, so if you've got, if you're emotionally intelligent, you would be able to handle these situations. Why? You know you are, you're self-secured, and you know you're not perfect, but you know you are working to get to a place, and you're there to help people. Okay, you're always there to assist. And when you're in that state of mind of serving, and that's our vision at the school, then you will be in calm, you will be in control, and doesn't matter what the situation is. It can be COVID or whatever, you'll be a leader, you'll be able to handle it, the grievance, the conflict, and you'll solve it. Last one, I don't think I have to read it, but respect is key. If you respect people, if there's a relationship, it will eliminate half of your problems. Right, thank you. You can continue with the work.